blessings to everyone from the true light, the one true light, the only light that there is. There is not two lights that need to be reconciled, that need to be integrated, that need to be combined, that need a compromise to be fashioned, that need to share authority. There are not two lights that need to share authority. There does not need to be a redemption from two lights. There does not need to be anything at all happen from two lights, because there are not two lights. There's only one light. So this is what has to be emphasized, because we are making these egregious mistakes because we don't realize this. We're very dualistic in the world right now. I call it lipstick culture, criminal lipstick culture. It's very funny today. I was out getting something in a store, and there's this car with a big decal on the back of it, and it was this bright pink lipstick, a picture of lips, bright pink lipstick, and engraved in the lipstick was a skull, was a death skull. And I said, that says it all, doesn't it? That says it all. Really, it does. Criminal lipstick culture, which is trying to put lipstick on this dualism and claiming that dualism is real, that there's trying to tell us that it can make, you put lipstick on the pretend mind, it'll make it real. As I say, putting lipstick on a pig. Well, we're trying to put lipstick on the pretend mind, and thereby we think we can make it real. So this lipstick culture is an abomination. Absolute abomination. And it's funny that for instance, earlier peoples, that's, for example, Christians, if they were to look at this culture, they would say, well, it's pagan. It's totally pagan. What are you talking about, Christians? There's no Christian, really? It's pagan right now. And they'd say, what in the world is this? It is. It's just we're keeping the superficial niceties of saying, well, it's still Christian culture, religious culture. It's not. And we have to be very careful in this world not to let dualism seep back into us and distort everything. And it has. We've dropped the ball. We've fumbled it away. And this is not surprising in the slightest bit. So I'm earnestly trying to keep the pipeline of truth into this world going, but I don't know how much longer I can go, because I cannot overcome the lipstick culture. It's so embedded now in our consciousness here that we think that men can't make the pretend mind real, but their mind's pretend, but women's pretend mind, that's real. Yeah, that's real. Why? Because they can dress it up better. They can make it seem real. So, well, men couldn't make it seem real enough, but women can make it seem real. And if it seems real, we think, well, that's good enough. That's all we can do with electromagnetism. Is pretend. Dress it, make it more pretense. Double down on pretense. More cowbell. Double down on pretense. This is what lipstick culture does. It doubles down on pretense and claiming that's the only remedy there is. I heard someone recently insist that this world's the only home we have. There is no other home. I just like, oh, you got to be kidding me. This is what they believe. That electromagnetism is our home and this planet is our home. What could be more foolish than to say something like this? We are home. Wherever we are, that is home. We are the light. To say that the light needs a home, but the light has no home, that this world is the home of light? Pure light, true light? This home is an appearance, appearing within light, as light, within pure spaciousness of clear light. The pure spaciousness of clear light is home, and that's everywhere. It's always and everywhere. So the foolishness of these times is unprecedented. It's off the charts. And we're simply fooling ourselves if we think that this situation is going to work out well. So I certainly can't change the culture. Not at all. There's this attitude now. that is so powerful, a pagan attitude. And it's the attitude, well, everybody has to go this direction. There isn't any other direction to go in. This is it. Well, it's not it. But we may need to take refuge at some point here, need to take refuge, because there's no way to stem the tide at this point. So I've always pointed out the importance of taking refuge. At some point, it'll be necessary to take refuge. You can get nowhere. And we get flustered. I get flustered. I'm trying to help everybody out, and they keep just delaying. And I try to act too quickly, and I end up making mistakes. And then they say, oh, you see, you're the one who's making mistakes. Well, I'm making mistakes because I'm trying to do too much and trying to help out those who refuse to attend class. In other words, what kind of student refuses to attend class? Those aren't students. Those are delinquents. So, taking refuge, there has to be some way. And I'm not sure. It has to be my fault. I'm trying to help out too much. I need to take care of myself a little bit. What can we do? What can we do? And the dreams don't seem to be helping much. We're certain to get an answer, an indication in some way. I just don't know exactly how to proceed. But I believe we have to keep on emphasizing the truth and accepting it. There has to be some sort of sticking point right now. That is still, you know, still some hang up. Very cold, chilly day today. Wow. Not very hospitable at all. I talked to somebody from Oregon today, and he said, what? This is wonderful. This is warm. I love it. I said, we go out in shorts and short sleeve shirt and out in, you know, sub freezing temperatures up there. And it's like, there's no problem here. He said, oh, this is balmy day. And like, here we are just like shivering and hiding in the house to turn up the heater more. It's terrible. So, you know, what you get used to, the world, those who like falsity, lies about truth, keep in mind that lies don't exist on their own. They can only be about truth, right? So lies are dependent, whereas truth is not dependent on lies. Truth isn't true because it's denying lies. It's lies that depend upon truth. Truth simply is true, whereas lies have to be lies about truth. They're derivative. See, lies have to be derivative. They have no base of their own whatsoever. But we keep being told that we can make it a base if we just dress the idol up more attractively. And this is lipstick culture. Dress the idol up. Give the idol more confidence. Give the idol more fashion, more attitude. The pretend mind. The pretend mind doesn't understand anything. We just put words in its mouth because it's not a mind. How can a pretend mind understand that it's a pretend mind and isn't a mind? How can a mind understand it isn't a mind? It's not possible. So the problem can never be solved at the level of the pretend mind at all. And this is what lipstick culture tells us. There's a way for pretend mind to understand. There's no mind there to understand. It's an imaginary mind. An imaginary mind has no power of understanding. It has no base at all as a mind. It's not a mind. It's pretending, a pretense. So I hope in some way this momentum will blossom very quickly. It seems that it's verging in this way. But there has to be something still that I'm still giving too much credit to littleness. What lipstick culture does is try to give magnitude to littleness. The idea of extreme littleness, which has to be the idea of separation, does it not? Because reality is allness. There's no littleness at all in reality, none. The idea of littleness is just a pretense, and then we try to give magnitude to this pretense. power and glory and all this to littleness, trying to glorify littleness. So lipstick culture is a glorifying culture of littleness. And we tend to glorify littleness right now. Right now in this culture now, we glorify children and youth and immaturity and all this. This is all being glorified. This is an example of glorifying littleness. It's just a symbol of it. Absolutely it is. In previous cultures, children were not glorified at all. It was the adults, mature adults, that this was the standard. And then the children said, this is something that I will grow into. And that this is the goal. But now the goal is to be childish, not in a spiritual way sense that we mean this, but in a way of littleness, of ignorance, of naivete, of believing in the pretend mind, of easily believing in these stories about pretend mind, being little in our understanding, and glorifying that. We're even now spending more attention on dogs than children. People dressing dogs up, treating dogs like their children, glorifying the littleness of understanding there in the animal mind. So lipstick culture turns towards fashion, it turns towards dressing up, it turns towards beautification of the body, it turns towards posing as powerful littleness posing. So when we want to try to glorify littleness, we turn towards female feminine culture. Women are smaller than men, and so to have the women in charge ruling things, we think, oh good, we're finally getting some magnitude to littleness. You see, this is how it goes. This is why the world is the way that it is now. Trying to empower littleness, absurdity. Okay, the notion of that a pretend mind is that we can be content with this, that spirit can be content with a pretend mind, is the idea of extraordinary littleness, and then trying to glorify that and empower it. So the currents in the world right now are truly diabolical in terms of the objective. And the idea is that we have no options. This is what the attitude I'm getting. It was spoken very clearly by a woman recently to me. We have no options. This is the only world we have, the only home we have. We're humans. This is it. We don't have any options. We say, unfortunately, we're completely stuck. This is lipstick culture. This is a lie. It's a big, big lie. Or you might say a little lie, a terribly little lie that we should dismiss as nonsense. Appearance can appear wherever it wants to appear, wherever spirit wants it to appear. This is mere appearance. This body is mere appearance. We're not bound anywhere. Appearance is not bound. How could it be? If appearance was bound, then God would be bound. Saying that we're not free is saying that God is not free, because God lives in us. We're the host of God. We're an extension of God. Spirit. So of course, the Bible points out that refuge is the way to go. There'll be a time when we'll need to take refuge. The world will be so sunk into littleness, worshiping littleness, that we need to take refuge from this. Lies are intrinsically little. This is a definition of littleness, right? It's the belief in littleness, aloneness. This whole world is like a recluse from truth. We're here as recluses. from truth. I don't want to be a recluse from truth. And we're being told that we can be content by being recluses from truth. And it's truly revolting beyond all measure at this point. The idea that we're supposed to be servants of littleness. The whole thing about birth itself is the belief in being servants of littleness, right? That we can become a little infant that needs others to serve the infant, serve littleness. We're formless spirit. We're not an infant. We're not little. We can't become little. I've always had no interest in littleness here in the world. No interest in children, no interest in having children, anything like this. And everything, all form is pretense. All process is pretense. Form, time, space, process, and form is 100% pretense. Now we can have the fake mind recede into the background. Absolutely we can. I had a sort of a meditation like this where all people had just disappeared, as it were. The people mind, the fake mind, disappeared. But we can say, well, it receded into the background of there's no need for a fake mind to apprehend nature, so to speak. There were just mountains and nature there. There was no fake mind apprehending this. There was no people apprehending it. And I was just perfectly fine with that. So there's no problem. What's the problem? So enlightenment can come at any moment. It really can. And so hopefully more than maybe, it will come for me here. And it just be simple and easy. But wow, how to help out the world? I don't know if it's possible. Again, lipstick culture is ruling the roost right now. Absolutely ruling the roost to an extraordinary extent. And we're supposed to all just be craven servants of this littleness. Whatever crisis they have, we have to jump to try to solve it. Oh, and the crisis, here's the thing, the problem right now is so severe is that fake mind pretense feels totally threatened by reality. Of course, if we believe pretense is real, what is the threat to this? Reality. Reality. And so lipstick culture feels very threatened right now because they feel there's some opportunity, but reality is very threatening to us. It wants to get rid of that. So it feels there's a crisis coming in that we may be attracted to the truth. For them, that's a severe crisis. For those who are attracted to the truth, it's lipstick culture itself that's the severe crisis, which is insisting that we all place our bets on littleness, place our bets on the pretend mind, that this is what is going, how we're going to find true contentment, a true eternal commitment is through this pretend mind. This is a crisis for those who want to return to sanity. So we have completely opposing ideas of what the crisis is. Totally opposite ideas of what the crisis is. And this is what I find. Lipstick culture mind believes the truth is the crisis. And we got to get rid of that. And of course truth believes that this push towards the pretend mind as being the one and only option we have, that's the crisis. So we may agree there's a crisis coming, everyone agree, but we may have very different ideas, opposing ideas of what the crisis is really about. And of course, all this technology that we have, artificial intelligence, all of this is designed to try to get us to buy into the pretend mind, saying we can teach it. We have better teaching aids now. We have computers to help teach the pretend mind that it's real. We think that the pretend mind just hasn't had enough self-esteem, hasn't had proper teaching, but if we give it proper teaching, it will realize its reality. So this is what's called false realization, false enlightenment. What is being taught in the world primarily now is false enlightenment, false realization, dualistic false enlightenment, false realization. There's a way to teach the pretend mind that it's real. And one day we think it'll dawn upon the pretend mind. Oh, I really am. I'm real mind. Oh, okay. Like that. But I don't mean, it will dawn upon the pretend mind that the pretend mind is the real mind. This is what I'm saying. So let's not get caught up, tricked by verbiage. Obviously, that's not true. What needs to dawn is the dawning needs to be upon the real mind, realizing that the pretend mind is merely pretend mind and has no reality whatsoever. That's the dawning that needs to happen. That's the realization, enlightenment needs to happen. That's the true enlightenment. True enlightenment is there's no fake mind to enlighten. It's the giving up of enlightenment. It's the giving up of realization in one way of looking at it. It's the giving up of being a savior. There is no savior to the pretend mind. The pretend mind is looking for a savior. Who will save me? Who will make me real? Who will make me real? The pretense is never real. It's never real. Now, it always comes from reality, but it's always an effect of reality. It is not causative. Never is pretense truly causative. So what fake mind, pretend mind wants is to be causative. It would say, oh, I really am causative. That can never happen. But we can delay the recognition that this can never happen by putting the lipstick on it. So this wretched, wretched, wretched modern culture is doing just that. They got it back upside down and backwards. Yeah, there's no possibility to teach these people, really, because they're looking for a savior. The way that what they're looking for in a savior is to make lies true. And there is no such savior. It doesn't exist. So they'll look at you and say, well, you're not a savior. You can't help me because you can't do what I'm asking you to do. And so they have a completely different idea of what realization, enlightenment, savior is all about. Totally upside down and backwards. And this is a psych out. I mean, it psychs us out. When we come here and want to help out genuinely, we get psyched out. Because it's so upside down and backwards here. It's just, eventually, it's just like it's so, it flusters us. It really does. I get flustered. We're under so much pressure now. I'm getting a little flustered at times, which is unusual for me, because we're running out of time. I mean, we're already, inundated with this lipstick culture, this dualistic false savior culture. And then we think all that the pretend mind needs is a mother to teach it properly. This is why we have the false cult of the mother. Mother goddess is so strong right now, is that we believe that, well, the what better to teach littleness than a mother, right? Because we all grow up as little children, and we think the mother teaches us how to become a real person, so to speak. But there's nothing like that happening at all. It's all pretend mind pretending all of this. But pretend mind, false dualistic belief, sees the mother as the answer. So they want to put this all, everyone focus on this all-powerful mother figure who can teach us how to grow and mature, how this pretend mind can mature. We think it's just lacking maturity. How can we say that nothing lacks maturity? How can we say that mere pretense lacks maturity? This is an insanity. Pretense is whatever we want it to be. There's no issue of maturity whatsoever, actually. No real issue whatsoever. How do you mature nothing? How can we say mature nothing has a maturity issue or a learning issue or a growing issue or it needs better mothering? This is ludicrous. And so just recognizing the ludicrousness of it is the dawning of true realization. It is the dawning. These recognitions are the dawn. This is what happens when realization is dawning, true realization. We get this clarity, we get this insight, we see more and more clearly, wow, that's absurd. Trying to mature nothing. Trying to bring nothing into some sort of growth. Pretense is all pretense. We can pretend some littleness and then pretend to grow it. It's still 100% pretense. It's quite a tricky illusion, isn't it? But it's so absurd, you know, there's really nothing to feed off of it. Is there just, okay, we just got to drop it. What else can we say about it? But we have to keep, you know, bringing it up over and over and over again, the absurdity of it. But this is why we have tipped over now into worshiping the mother, worshiping the feminine, which because the feminine is the role of the mother. That's why. And this mother knows best ideology is now in a situation where we say, well, yeah, but only the mother knows how to, the child of pretense, how to mature it. So we all need to worship the mother. And now then women are saying to all men that the way to worship the mother is to worshiping them. And that they are connected to the mother. They have the mother principle in them. And the only path for salvation for men is through women. This is exactly the ideology that has been promoted here for quite some time, and has become this unbelievably terrible spiritual virus, as it were, that has pulled us into madness, insanity, actually, very severe insanity. The Holy Spirit is the one that deals with the continuity problem that spirit has, true mind has, so it can gradually recognize that pretend mind, there's no mind in pretend mind other than the one mind that is pretending it. So it's the Holy Spirit is our Savior, not the mother. Okay, the Holy Spirit is our Savior. God created the Holy Spirit specifically to ultimately collapse all time, the belief in time. So it's the Holy Spirit that is God's unique creation specifically to deal with this insanity of pretense and the continuity fear around that. That's it. So it's the Holy Spirit that's our Savior, period. It's not a mother that is our Savior. It's not any mother figure that's our Savior. That's an abomination to believe this. And the Holy Spirit has never given birth to anything, right? There's no mother principle in the Holy Spirit whatsoever. It's pure reason, pure pragmatism, pure reason, divine reason, which keeps pointing out to us. And Jesus is perfectly aligned with the Holy Spirit and the whole mission here of our salvation from pretense. Based on our continuity fears, says, I'm afraid of true mind, my functioning in true mind, so I'm trying to make pretend mind real. That can never work. That can never work. No matter how much we wait for it to happen. And of course, you say, well, the mother's very patient. She'll wait until it happens. Doesn't matter how long we wait. Waiting there's no causative principle in waiting for the sake of having pretense become real. Now we, on the path of true salvation, we need to be patient as we allow the wow, the resonance of the wow, the shock of the wow to get used to it. So there is an issue of familiarity and patience in regard to familiarity, but it's a positive thing. When we get shocked, that's a positive shock, and we're getting used to that. We're getting comfortable with it. So it's not a waiting. It's a. You can say we're getting comfortable with truth, more and more comfortable with truth. And it just may seem that we're not mentally as active once the shock hits us, the wow hits us. That's true. But it's not this type of waiting for lies to become true. Not at all. And that this is all glossed over by lipstick culture. All these important distinctions are just, you know, glossed over entirely. It's just, not important. And they're just, you know, no interest, zero interest in it. And hoping by zero interest it'll somehow magically disappear. Reality will somehow stop being real. That the Holy Spirit will somehow stop being an advocate for truth if we just don't pay any attention to it. Well, there's no chance of that happening either. Even if all of us try to default, Holy Spirit is still 100% actively aware of truth and its mission to save us from our self-delusion. So we're just, all we're doing is delaying. This is a delay. We can't outwait the Holy Spirit. I mean, the Holy Spirit will wait for us in a positively attentive way. Not in a magical waiting way, but is always available for us, any opportunity to help us out. Can't get rid of that. And yet, lipstick culture sees this as a threat. The Holy Spirit's a terrible threat. So they're taking drastic action to get rid of this threat. And you just can't function in this world under these circumstances very effectively at all going forward. This is obviously true. I feel this way, that you are, the attitude, for instance, of women is that men are their slaves. Men are subservient. And they expect this attitude to be present all the time. And it's just this blatantly obvious now. I mean, the difference between, you know, older generation of women and the younger generation is night and day. Night and day. Night and day, it's so different. In the store today, these young women, the attitude, I just feel it. It's just like we're the princesses, and you serve us. All men serve us. And there wasn't any doubt in their mind about it, because they've grown up in a culture where this is the way everything functions here. So they don't know anything different. And, you know, no one dares say the empress has no clothes, has no chance, to dress up pretense. They think that's an outrageous comment to make. They say, oh, no, we can dress pretense up so beautifully that it will become real. This is arrogance, sheer arrogance. So there's this extraordinarily arrogant attitude through the women of the world, younger women, mostly. The older women, some of them are trying to get hip and you know, catch the contagion. And some are just, you know, just trying to get by. And not all the older women are so corrupted, actually. But the ones who are trying to stay young by adopting this princess culture idea, you know, they are very corrupted. Very, very corrupted. Not their spirit, but their ideology is extraordinarily corrupted. Their belief, they're believing in corruption, basically, yeah. That somehow pretense can corrupt reality, that which is pretending. How can pretense corrupt the pretender, actually? When the pretender is pure light, pure mind, pure light. There's no corruption taking place. This is what Jesus pointed out to us. Now, Jesus didn't have to take appearance as a birth, but he did so, and he didn't really, it was just a mere appearance. There's no such thing as real birth or real childhood or any of this. It's pretense, mental pretense. But he said, I'm going to mentally pretend an appearance of being born, grow up as a child, and then go through this crucifixion just to prove to everybody that this all this is pretense. That's all that it is, because everyone's saying, no, Jesus, you're wrong. If you actually were born here of a woman, you would realize that you need to grow and mature, and that women can teach you how to do that, and they're very important, that the female principle is a real principle of pretense. It's the part that helps pretense become real. So your criticism of duality is all mistaken, Jesus, and you're wrong. And Jesus said, look, I'll prove it to you. So appeared to be born of a woman here in the world and have a mother and grow up and all this. And then he said, hey, you know, woman, why are you crying? He renounced it, said, no, this is, you don't understand why I'm here at all. And so then he did his thing, went through the appearance of death, and then resurrected and said, look, it's all appearance. It's all pretense. There's no causative agency to it whatsoever. I just proved it to you with my birth, my life, and my crucifixion, and my resurrection. This is the proof I give to you. Now, he doesn't have to do that again. He's already back in this world. He didn't come back here through a birth to a woman. No, absolutely not. He simply appeared here. Simply appeared here. All bodies are mere pretense. So therefore, birth must be mere pretense also. It is. Children are pretense. Mothers are pretense. Fathers are pretense. Pretending. Light pretending that it is somehow. This is what the way that light has to function now through time, space, process, and form. That it serves. This is what it's serving. No. This is just an idea in the mind of spirit. Of asking light to pretend to not be light. Say, light, I want you to change what you are. So this light is pretending all this. Because we want the pretense. We want it. We're curious about it. Jesus is not curious about it. But they demanded proof. He gave proof. So that's it. And what do you do when someone demands proof? You give the proof and they still don't. They still reject it. Now, what can you say? They're just trying to glorify littleness then. They're just continuing delay. You can't give them any respect for that. You need not side with it at all. This happens all the time when people try to bluff and you call their bluff and then they just say, sour grapes and walk away and don't refuse to repent at that point. Whereas history is full of people who have repented when confronted with the falsity of their ways. They said, I see that, you know, truth is true and lies are lies. And lies can never be true. And they repent. But many do not. They're still curious about pretense. Curious about delay and pretense. Curious about pretense. Thinking, what kind of power does pretense have? Well, it has no power. And they say, well, what kind of power can we give it? We can't give it any power. We're trying. We're trying to empower it. This whole thing, empowering the feminine, is really an attempt to empower pretense. 100%. Lock, stock, and barrel. It's an attempt to empower pretense. And this is why so many of us have said, no. Not going down that road. And they say, well, you're discriminating. No, we're not siding with littleness. God does not tell us we have to side with littleness against God. Absolutely not. Little-mindedness, you know, pretense-mindedness. We don't have to side with pretense. There's nothing there to discriminate against. It's pretense. Saying that it's discriminatory is saying that pretense has some reality to it, a self to it. It doesn't have any self. So how can we be discriminating against a self that doesn't exist? It's ridiculous. The only discrimination in this world is against truth. The only truth can be discriminated against, actually. And this whole world is an exercise in discrimination against truth. This whole electromagnetic universe is an exercise in discrimination against truth. Only truth is true. Truth can't discriminate against anything at all. There's only truth. It's lies that are the discriminatory. And are nothing at all, actually. Nothing at all. Wow, this is very polar feeling this today. I have to stay fired up or I'll get cold here. How are we doing? Oh, wow, I haven't gone, only 39. I feel like I've been talking for a long time. I don't know how I'll get through a long video here, but stay fired up. Let's stay fired up. And those who are waiting for the impossible to happen, those who are trying to help them, we get frustrated because they're just refusing to listen. They're playing dumb. They're just playing dumb. It's all they're doing is playing dumb. Of course, that's very frustrating for us who are trying to help out. How could it not be? And again, when you see a crisis coming and everybody keeps playing dumb, this is very frustrating. We don't have the overview of the Holy Spirit that sees, you know, everything is already accomplished. So we can get frustrated. Again, playing dumb is an intentional, willful strategy of delay. What other strategy is there but to play dumb? It's just a pretense, playing dumb and saying, well, the pretense mind told me. No pretense mind told anyone to be dumb. Every bit of content of a so-called pretense mind is just words put into the mouth of a speaker. It's like somebody speaking through a speaker, a microphone through a speaker, and then claiming the speaker is somehow producing, is causing what is being spoken. This is the mistake we're making. We think if we see a speaker and we hear the sound come out of the speaker, we think, oh, the speaker is speaking. This particular, you know, this speaker box is the one doing the speaking, causing these ideas to come out. Totally neglecting the actual speaker who's speaking the words through a microphone and through this acoustic speaker, audio speaker. So there's a true speaker and there's an audio speaker. Which one is causative? One just vibrates from the true speaker. It's not truly causative. It's not ideationally causative at all. It's just a mechanism, communication mechanism, that we think we need. But the pretense mind is like a sock puppet. It's like a puppet. We're having this puppet talk, and we think the puppet has a self to it. There's no self to a puppet, to a marionette. And we say, oh, we don't want to offend the self of the puppet. How dare you say it? So the puppet thinks that's offensive. Don't you, puppet? And the puppet says, yes, I certainly think that. Very, very offended by this. You see, the puppet's offended. You've hurt the puppet's self. You've diminished the puppet's self. The reason why the puppet doesn't have, you think it doesn't have a self, is because you're so negative and diminishing of the puppet. And this really hurts the puppet's feeling, doesn't the puppet? It causes me so much problem. Sometimes I don't feel like I have a self. It's so awful. You know, and this is the conversation the world is having. They're having a conversation with a puppet. And thinking they're having a meaningful conversation, that they need to have a discussion with this puppet, with the puppet self, the self of the puppet. Say to puppet, I don't want to diminish yourself. You know, that's awful. Let me see if I can. How do I strengthen yourself? Well, you need to do what my mother tells you to do. Myself has a mother, and she knows how to strengthen me myself. And you need to listen to her and do what she tells you to do. Oh, really, puppet? Yeah. Is that what I need to do? This is what we're being told. We're putting words in the puppet's mouth. Of course we are. And yet everybody's playing puppet dumb. They have no idea what you're talking about. You must be crazy. You know, you tell you the truth, and the puppet says, oh, you must be crazy. Myself thinks you're crazy. Now, there's no self there to think that I'm crazy. There isn't any such self. These are just words coming from spirit, who is still curious about pretense and delay, trying to empower what, you know, effects, trying to make effects causative, which, of course, is what spirit's trying to be greater than God, trying to claim that effects were an effect of God, but were an extension of God, which is a little different, but we can say, for the purpose of conversation, that we're like an effect trying to be causative. We want to be the causation of God. So we're trying to reverse the direction of creation. Now, this sounds like we've heard this all before, but we're hearing it more and more clearly now. It's the same thing being said. Truth doesn't change with the seasons. It's the same truth. So we're emphasizing the truth, but we're doing it over and over and over and over and over. And it gets clearer and clearer and clearer, and more and more adamant, more and more adamant, more and more adamant. We're less and less divided on this, is he? We're feeling less and less guilt towards this non-existent puppet self. Like, so, you know, it's like the puppet says, oh, if you're enlightened, you're going to get rid of myself. You're going to kill the self. How terrible. There isn't any self there, puppet, to kill. But the puppet tells us that. I mean, you need to kill the ego. You need to kill the self. Oh, but how terrible. There's no guilt. There's no self there. We're just putting words in the puppet's mouth. Puppet's going to say this. So we move our jaws of the body. The body's just a puppet. We move the jaws. We make sounds. The body's not generating the thinking, the thoughts, the ideation at all. It's just a puppet. It's a marionette. I mean, we don't want to hurt the marionette self's feelings, do we? I got to go up to San Francisco soon. It's like going into the heart, like in the 18th, 19th century, let's say. It'd be like going into the heart of the Congo. Is I feel Livingston's got to go into the heart of the Congo. You know, it's like, oh my gosh. Got to go to San Francisco. The heart of puppet culture. Puppet self culture. Everybody there feels that their puppet self is quite aggrandized, quite has great magnitude. Not everybody, but just about. I don't know how anyone could live there and not be thoroughly contaminated. But it's that way everywhere now, isn't it? It's just they're leading, San Francisco's a leading advocate of puppet culture, lipstick culture. Maybe I'll take a camera. How about that? Is that possible? Shall I take my camera? Can I get away with that? I don't know. It's an idea, isn't it? Go up to San Francisco and start taking some video. Wow. That would be, I mean, that's like I said, going to the heart of the Congo in pre-colonial, early colonial times and taking video of the savages there. Savage culture. So what they, you know, it was pretty savage, you know, despite all the political correctness. If you really find out the truth about some of those cultures in Africa, make your blood curdle. But that's not politically correct to even speak of such things, is it? But I'll tell you, for me, like going into San Francisco is like I'm going to the cannibal land. I can probably get away with it by pretending to be a tourist, you know. I don't know. It's an interesting idea, isn't it? Maybe I'll ask. Any thoughts for YouTube? Any thoughts? Do you have any? What are your thoughts on reality? Any thoughts you have on reality? Oh God. I don't know how it's possible. It's like surreal, going through a surreal insane asylum. And yet, they think they're like the height of sophisticated intelligence, the cutting edge of consciousness in the world. They've got that puppet self really well educated. It's doing great. It's almost there. Almost there, just needs the finishing touches. The mother has to come and just give a little more advice, is what they're thinking. They're almost, you know, almost reached the goal. But they need a whisperer, a goddess whisperer, to whisper the final secret in their ear. And of course, a lot of them are pretending they've got the goddess already. The goddess has already whispered to them, this is the psych out in the world right now. As these two young women here, they're like that. They act like, well, yeah, I know the answer. You know, you don't know it yet, but we know it. We know it. The goddess has whispered to us. No, they're actually just acting, actresses, pretending that something's been whispered to them. Nothing's been whispered to them because there's nothing to whisper. And this is the psych out. The females are very good actresses and able to psych out, do the psych out, because they pretend that this mystery has been revealed to them. Actually, there is no mystery to reveal. It's all bluff. It's all 100% a bluff. But they're all in on the bluff right now. This is the problem. They're all in on the bluff. So they're very brittle right now. Very, very brittle. They should wear cowboy boots and a cowboy hat. Howdy, y'all. So where are you from? I'm from Texas. Or I'm from the South down here. Just kind of taking a look and see what you're all doing up here. And wow, it's really interesting. Kind of look at you. Oh, my gosh. You're Southern? Oh, wow. What a heck. You know, yeah, look at that building. My gosh. Look at these people strutting. Look at these ladies strutting around in the stiletto heels and tights and acting like they're ruining the world. This is, wow, this is really something. So, I don't know. I don't have cowboy boots anymore, though. Maybe I can go get some. If you act like you're from Europe or something, yeah, maybe they won't bother you. You just have to act like you're stupid. And then they cut you a little bit of slack. Yeah, you're just not able to understand the grace that you're under, you know, by being there. You're being so blessed and graced by even being there, you're just not able to understand it, but they're cutting you a little slack. Maybe. I feel like it's like Jonah going to Nineveh. Yeah. Who wants to go to Nineveh? Back then, the heart of darkness, of course, they felt they were the light upon the hill. And, you know, those who believe in this puppet self are becoming more and more brittle and more hostile. And of course, the more tolerant they towards this, so you got to be more tolerant to this puppet self, this non-existent pretend self, pretend mind. And the reason why this pretend mind doesn't seem to be real is because you're not tolerant enough of it. And so they like say you have to be tolerant of this fake self, and if you're not, we're gonna crush you. And they don't understand. Gee, maybe they're not being so tolerant to truth. Are they being tolerant to truth? No. The problem is that truth is not tolerant to this pretend self, and if it was just tolerant, this pretend self would be real. And it's the lack of tolerance on the side of lack of Christian tolerance and this that's causing this pretend self not to be to feel it's not real. It really is real, just feels it's not real. So this is the problem. You know, this is the ideology of the ego, of insanity. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear it. They think that this is the mecca of reality, San Francisco. San Francisco believes that they're the mecca of reality. And so anyone who wants to go away from it is disgraceful, is shameless. You know, you're turning your back on truth. This is how they feel. They're turning your back on truth. I've had people tell me that. Not just San Francisco, the Bay Areaites, as it were, but even others with this. I've had it in pretty shocking. I don't want to name names because they can always repent and change their ways, right? But let's just say even representatives of Jesus claiming to be representatives and really enlightened culture who claim to be, you know, the most enlightened and teaching, they, even when I said, hey, I'm working on my own way of helping Jesus, they said, oh, you're turning your back on truth, you're turning your back on Jesus, what a disgrace, what a shame, God, well, you're going to feel terrible, you feel so terrible, the whole cult guilt trip thing, yeah, like, oh, you don't want to make this, the pretend mind real, wow, you're going to be without a mind then. Once we make the pretend mind real, we will know that you didn't support that and you weren't tolerant of that. And then you will be cast out into darkness. Wow, I don't know. Turning me loose with a camera is always very interesting, isn't it? If I want to be gutsy, I don't know if I get out of there alive, is the only thing. But I'm pretty good at being low-key in it. Holy Spirit helps me out. I don't know. It's like slipping into a dugout canoe on the Congo River and say, here we go. Of course, I come from a family of intrepid explorers, actually. I have my whole family tree, at least on one side, has many, many great explorers in it, including my dad. My dad was actually a great explorer. Explored the jungles of both. He walked across the equator, Africa at the equator, through the Congo, actually, through the whole Congo jungle. Walked across Africa back in, the 1940s. Something like that, or is it pre? It should have been just after the war. Discovered temples in Guatemala, in the jungle, going through the jungles with massive tarantulas and poisonous snakes and everything. He was a very intrepid explorer. But what I'm doing is exploring the mind, which is even more intrepid. You have to be super intrepid to do that. Recognizing, you know, the delusion here, the pretense here. That is the most intrepid exploring there is. So, like I said, I come from a long ancestry and lineage of very intrepid explorers. Exploring the North Pole, for instance, part of our family tree. Admiral Burr is part of our family tree, explorer of the North Pole, great intrepid explorer. But I turn the exploring towards the mind and truth, non-dual truth, and this whole massive pretense of electromagnetism. Now that's quite a trip I've been on. I've met many savages along the way, to be sure. Very savage and vicious beliefs and put-downs and all of this stuff. You know, we're going to eat you alive. We're going to curse you. You know, if someone curses you, you say, great, I love curses, except they have to be perfect. You know, if they're not perfect, they're not good enough for me. Now, this came to me recently as someone, a friend of ours, was being cursed by some lady. It's a lady who's being cursed by some lady, a very nice, very good lady, a very nice lady, very pragmatic lady. And she didn't do what someone, princess wanted, and this princess is cursing her. Severely cursing her, trying to put a curse on her. And I just thought, hey, Holy Spirit, what do you do when someone curses you? You say, well, thank you. You're cursing me? Great. I've always wanted to be cursed. Thank you so much. But I have to tell you that it has to be a perfect curse. It has to be immaculate, perfect, eternal curse. Otherwise, you know, it's not good enough for me, so I can't accept it. So hopefully it is a perfect curse. I don't know if it is, but, you know, just flip the script on them like that. Don't get all defensive. I just say, wow, thank you. Thank you. That's great. What an adventure. I'm being cursed. Awesome. This is agree with your adversary training, which Jesus advises us in. Agree with your adversary. Someone curses you, thank him for it. Thank you. But just say but I hope it's a perfect curse, because I can only accept perfect curses, because after all, I'm perfect. So I only deal in perfection. Otherwise, it just wouldn't work. And people say, you're stupid. Yeah, I'm perfect. That's right. I'm perfectly immaculately stupid. Eternally perfectly immaculately stupid. That's absolutely right. You're wrong. Yeah, I'm absolutely perfectly wrong. Always perfect. Perfect. Oh, it's incredibly immaculate perfection in wrongness. But we have to deal with the actual stuff that's going on here in pretense land. And it's terrible. You go up to San Francisco, you get drugged secondhand smoke, pot smoke everywhere, It's terrible. But they say, oh no, it's good for you. You know, cigarette smoke will kill you, but pot smoke, it's great for you. Nobody dumber than potheads, I'll tell you that. Because it's the pot puppet talking. You know, he says, oh, this helps pretend, makes pretense beautiful. I like this pretense. I like the pretending, trending. Yeah, we can dress pretending up with drugs. I don't know, safari too. We could take a San Francisco safari. Maybe that's the name of the video. San Francisco safari. We gotta wear a safari hat. I used to have one. I used to have all sorts of stuff. Not anymore. But yeah. And safari clothes will have the, you know, the full epaulettes and all the little pockets. And we're going to San Francisco safari. What's that? Go take a look at the denizens of the jungle, San Francisco jungle. I mean, they're all good people.
Sure.
Everybody's good people. That doesn't mean they're not completely cuckoo. You know, they are. But they're still spirit, you know. They're still spirit. They're just pretending not to be. So they're still, you know, they're perfect. They're still perfect. They're still wonderful. I get along fine with everybody, actually. But I don't side with the insanity. I don't side with the littleness. That's the only difference. Jesus didn't side with it, right? No, absolutely not. But he treated everybody very, very, knowing that they're the one spirit, just like, you know, he is. But he didn't side with the littleness. You know, I'm not supposed to side with insanity. We don't, I'm supposed to believe that this puppet self is real. No, we realize there isn't any self there. I don't have to view the world through this false self. That doesn't, you know, hate the sin, love the sinner. This is the attitude. This is the attitude I have, absolutely. I try not to be mean to anybody. I'm very, very kind to everybody. And I mean it. I wish nothing but the best for everyone. Always. I wish everyone be liberated from falsity right now, this instant. And remain always liberated. Period. That's my attitude. I don't want anyone to suffer another instant. And I want the freedom, this instant freedom right now, to last forever. No backsliding for anyone. This is my prayer for everyone. And will continue to be. Now Jesus tells us when we're able to pray that way, enlightenment will come to us. Well, I hope so. It hasn't yet. But, you know, he says, well, you must be making an exception. Well, I keep trying not to, that's for sure. But I have faith in what he says is it must be true. It's reasonable to believe, plausibly infer that it is true. He says the way to be free is give freedom to everyone else. The way to be free of suffering is to truly give freedom from suffering from everyone. And freedom from suffering is not just they're not suffering now. It means they're never going to suffer anymore again. So it's not like I want someone to feel good for a while and then I want to be not feel good. No, I want everyone to feel good forever. No backsliding. And this is abidance. I want them to abide in the now of freedom from pretense, pretensual suffering. So maybe that's where my abidance will come from, is this attitude. This is what Jesus tells us. This is how it has to happen. You cannot wish any aspect of the sonship not be fully abiding in freedom and still experience your own freedom. That's not possible, because then you're believing in separation, and which is pretense. Boy, it needs to heat up here. The sun was out a little bit today, so it was a nice day. No, the clouds came. It is not. When the sun goes behind a cloud, my gosh, it is a very raw feeling to it. We're not used to this at all. Flee to the desert. It's even cold air. It's not even warm in the desert. chilly, 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 chilly. San Francisco Safari. Now, San Francisco used to be pretty interesting because it had people, vagrants from all over the world came there. And so you had this very polyglot culture, and it was quite a zoo, to say the least. But people were, you know, like being arrivistas from other countries, they were everyone trying to be very nice, you know, in San Francisco, trying to be very nice to them. And so there's this feeling of niceness kind of there. But now I think it's a feeling more of arrogance there. We'll see. We'll see. Okay, maybe I'll get some first-hand look at San Francisco. Maybe I should start San Francisco safaris. I don't know. I want to go someplace where that reinforces truth, though. Why would I want to go in such a place? Just what, to document it? Yeah. I don't know. I don't feel like I really need to do that, but I have to go up there anyway. I used to go up to San Francisco. Where are you from? I'm from Mars, man. Where are you from? Literally. I'm not making that up. I'm from planet Krypton. Maybe they were. That was their previous life. Wouldn't be surprising. A lot of nowadays, I mean, there's so much money in San Francisco. I mean, it's probably the most expensive living place in the world right now. You have to be a filthy rich to even rent an apartment there. So these people are just, you know, they're fashionistas, they're shopaholics, they're techies. I mean, every brand of modern zoo animal imaginable is up there right now. You know, preening in their pretense. Potentially preening. And you have a lot of homeless people also using them, but that's sad. And it's a refugee city also, and what do you call it, a something city, where laws don't apply. They don't apply the laws to those who they feel they don't want to apply them to. Sanctuary city, yeah. It's where a lot of the gaming industry comes from. Video games, the gaming industry, and all the, you know, reptilian culture, basically. High-tech reptilian culture comes from there. So it's one of the heart centers of it, if you want to use that term. But in general, it's just, you know, pretense, believing that there's a way to make the pretense real. How are we doing here? Oh, good. We reached an hour. Very chilly. Very chilly indeed here. Wow. That's coming up soon. Holy cow. Better get the batteries charged and. Of course, everybody takes video with their iPhones now. I don't have an iPhone. I don't have an iPhone or smartphone. But, you know, they take video all the time. Hey, man. Everybody walking around scanning everything. We're getting real, you know, we're getting close to being real now. Everybody's very close to being real. We're all connected now. We connect all these pretend minds, and the pretend mind is going to ignite and become real. And we can finally realize this is our only home, our true home here, and be content with it. And my gosh, we're on the edge of the millennia. You know, we're on the edge of the millennia. The millennium. This is the belief. More likely we're on the edge of a asteroid hitting us, actually. That's the punishment, the mother's punishment upon her children who just don't listen to her. She says, mother's getting frustrated. She says, you pretend children, you just don't listen to me. If you listen to me, you'd become real. Yeah, but so I'm going to punish you first, and so you know the wrath of the mother. So going forward, you will make sure that you listen to me and learn how to become real. This is, so don't think that the mother, you know, they got it right in India. Kali cuts up everyone's head. Mother Kali. Yeah, she says, you're not getting it, so off with your head. Now, that may seem simplistic to some erudite scholars about Kali, but I understand the flip side and various other aspects of it too, but it's also a truism to point this out. It's helpful pragmatically to point this out, that the mother has a very punishing aspect to her. And of course, the mother is just pretense too, 100%. But we're trying to use pretense, the mother pretense, to get the self pretense, the mind pretense, to grow up into a real mind. Real mind, the idea that we can grow minds. You know, this whole thing, what are we doing in the world? We're growing minds. No, we're not. We're just engaging in pretense. But the mother is the grower of mind. So we haven't grown into what we're hoping to become. So we're going to have the mother punish us, and severely punish us. The goddess of destructivity is here in this world, so to speak, that attitude. I very much experienced that. The streets of San Francisco, safari on the streets of San Francisco. Maybe you'll have a, I don't know what I'll do. You never know. I never know. I just go with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit wants something to happen. It happens. And speaking of happening, maybe I need to get inside right now, because it is truly. I hope everybody's enjoying the videos. Not getting many comments or likes or anything. So I really don't know what's going on. The recent one with the graphics of all the beautiful shifts between scenery. The landscapes, I can't remember the name of it, echoes of plausible inference or something like that. I watched it several times. It's beautiful. Every time I watch it, it's better, actually. I mean, it's just, the more I watch it, I say, wow, this is actually, the video turned out really great. I didn't know it would, but it turned out really fantastic. I put tremendous amount of work into it, actually, too much, but the result is something that I like to watch again and again and again. I haven't put any music with it yet, but just the transitions all go into these little pieces, and they kind of like confetti, and then they kind of turn into twinkling little stars and start, you know, all this stuff, and it's just. There's an aesthetic beauty to it that I'm very pleased with, very, very pleased with. So I thank the Holy Spirit for that. Hopefully it'll get more and more views, and people will warm up to it. Our minds will warm up to it. But don't expect the pretend mind to warm up to anything. It is not a mind. It has no capacity for true appreciation of truth. It can't appreciate truth. Pretend mind does not appreciate truth. There's no real appreciation of truth there at all. In fact, it doesn't know anything, because it's not a mind. It doesn't exist as a mind at all. All pretense exists merely as pretense, nothing else. But San Franciscans can be very intimidating, because they are metropolitan, in a metropolitan sense, very sophisticated and very rich. Go to a Giants baseball game, and the people walking around, they just go, whoa. I mean, they're all the latest style. I mean, they're just like, they just finished a shopping spree or something. And, I mean, the young bucks and scion of San Francisco, I mean, these people are loaded with power and money and sophistication, and you know, it runs deep there. It runs deep. So they can be quite intimidating, no doubt about it. Sophisticates, city sophisticates. San Francisco's always been a very sophisticated city called Paris of the West. What do they look down their noses at Los Angeles? Would they think that's some kind of ghetto? You know, that there's no culture down there at all. But actually, LA does have a very heavy art culture. Tremendous patronage of the arts down there, in various arts. There's a very elite group in Los Angeles of culture, very elitist culture down there too, actually, that also has a lot of money. It's just like the San Franciscans look down their nose. Peons, savage, barbarians down there in Los Angeles. So I get to be looked at as a hick, redneck hick. Great. Yeah, we'll see. Interesting. I'm intrigued by this. I don't know. Maybe curiosity killed the cat. Maybe shouldn't be so intrigued by it. I don't know. Do that thing of walking, the guy who does all the videos, the gentleman, the intrepid brother who walks through cities with his camera, to do that through San Francisco, probably pretty interesting. The fashion up there is, I can tell you right now, what is the fashion in San Francisco? Black. Everybody wears black. If you're not wearing black, I'm going to wear white, of course. Everyone not wearing black, there's something wrong with you. I mean, head to toe. They've invented many, many shades of blackness up there. They wear black all year because it's always winter in San Francisco. Because what did Mark Twain say? The coldest winter I ever spent was summer in San Francisco. And that's a truism. Absolutely, it's true. And someone just told me they 15 degrees below zero. They said it was cold, but they said, but San Francisco, the cold's a lot worse there in summer. The fog, the windy fog, blowing that fog. I mean, you're going to get hypothermia in a hurry from that stuff. So, black is always du jour there. Yeah, you show up in white there, they know you're... Look at this cowboy from the Outback showed up here. My gosh, wearing white. Hi guys, it's lovely to be here. Wow. But everything up there is so decadent. I mean, how can I include it in the video, right? I mean, it'll pollute everyone's mind. I'm starting to shiver. I better go very inside. I'm really starting to shake and shiver. This is... Oh my gosh. I gotta stay active in weather like this. So I'm hanging in there. I'm still taping. I gained 4 pounds over the last several days, which is hideous. Absolutely hideous for me, because it's so difficult for me to get weight off. A week of intense starvation, I lose a pound. But in 3 days, I gained 4 pounds. Terrible. Very disappointed in this. Even though I'm active and running around, still the same. So, that's my misery for the day, right now. I gotta find a way to lose those 4 pounds. How in the world, wow. Take me a month to chop off those 4 pounds. I lose a pound a week, that's about a month to lose the 4 pounds. That's crazy. And gain it all back in several days. This is my tragedy. So, I hope everyone's in good humor. Keep the good humor flowing, the spiritual humor, right? This existential humor is the only humor there is. The humor of this, all this pretense and the folly of it and the struggle with it. We need to laugh at this, how silly it is. Otherwise, they might take it seriously. We might take pretense seriously. We need to keep the humor about it. getting hypothermia. Gotta go. All right. Stay fired up. Stay fired up. And I'm encouraging everyone to do just that. All right. That's it. That is it.